best time for a resume workshop with an India-Pakistan match going on, but yeah, we hope it's useful.
Good evening, everyone. So thank you coming for the PG Resume Workshop, and special thanks for taking time during an important match of India-Pakistan. So we'll be wrapping up soon, but let me emphasize first before we begin that this is extremely important. Being into the team, we have realized that there is something, you know, lacking in our PG resume when you compare it to UGs. So we have our two speakers here. Mr. Manendra Singh Parihar, our placement manager of the last season and the man behind giving us very good stats for the MDex. And Mr. Nitish Kholgade, he was with us as a company coordinator in 2013-14. And presently he is working in fractal analysis. He was placed on the campus placement in HSBC. So I'll welcome them both to give us some enlightenment on how to continue with our resume. And hope you find this session useful. So handing over the mic.
It's good to see you all coming in such a good numbers during this match. So it's the first step that you have taken towards your placements, giving importance to your placements over a final match. So we'll be beginning with the resume building workshop, which is a very essential workshop for MTech students. As you all understand that the quality of the resumes that we have from our BTech is not something which will stand here in IIT Bombay when you're competing with the other undergrads as well and your PG fellow mates. So we'll tell you the importance of having the resume workshop at this moment of time, because the timeline speaks about that will be starting with the assessments in month of July. So you should be having your first draft of a resume at least ready before that, so that you can get the feedback from the officials coming from various companies with the assessment firms. So that is one important thing, that you should be ready with the resumes by first week of July. And then the registration and everything will take over in first week of August, and then you will not be getting time to improve on your resume. So that is one important thing that you have to consider right now and start working on resume. So there are three phases of resume building. So very first phase is to start the data mining the content, whatever you have in your resume, what you can put, from what all sources you can bring more quality to your resume. So first stage is content mining, then second stage is presentation, how you present your resume. That brings a uniqueness in your resume. And third is personalize.
Just on content mining, if you guys have made a resume during your undergrads, which you've used for campus placements in your undergrad schools, that's a good starting point. At least you have content there and you can add your master's degree content.
So the very first stage of resume building is content mining, that you have to start right now. So the best way to start with content mining is you make a draft, you make a Google Doc or something, and you start dumping everything, whatever you have done till now. So in that way, you will not skip on anything, and you can make 3-4 resumes out of that. So the very best strategy is you dump everything, whatever you have done in your past, say 5-6 years, or during your schooling also, whatever you have done, you start dumping somewhere in a Google Doc, so that you do not miss on these things. And you can prioritize what all the things you want to put in which resume. So we have options of 5 resumes in placement portal. So you can have tech resume, you can have one resume for analytics, one for software. So.
You guys know what's the meaning of chronological, right? You go time-wise. So obviously nobody cares much about what you did in school in campus interview. However, what you did in undergrad would be very critical. So it's your choice. Either you could go chronological from year one of BTech all the way till the present, or go the other way around, go reverse chronological. If you want to give more importance to the latest, which is the best way to go about it. People want to know what you've done in the recent past. So go backwards. So that way you won't miss out on anything. Make a list of all that you've done, internships, projects, whatever courses you've done. So go in the reverse chronological way. That would be my advice.
And at this stage, it is important to get the resumes of the seniors. Like whatever fields you want to try and do, you should have resumes of your seniors so that you can have some idea about how much information do you need and how to put information. So the second stage, which is presentation, is something which depends on you. So we have a fixed header in the resume. In bottom of that, you can put anything in whatever format you want. So like this is a standard format that we generally follow here in IITB. But you will find that in one page resume only we are putting all the information that we have done in say last 6-7 years. That is one important thing, that you must not be having experience of having a one page resume, because we generally have used to prefer a two page resume over one page in UG. So like here you can see one standard format of a resume. Like this you can use colors also, it's totally up to you. So here you will see two important words, which are impact and quantify.
There's one thing that I noticed when I was in the placement office, and I compared the undergrad resumes with the PG resumes that were already existing in the database or with some of my seniors, is the PGs tend to list what they've done, you know, that I did this, or I was involved in this NGO, this and that. But people want to know what impact you had in that NGO, or people want to know what impact you had in that six-month BTEC project. So when we say impact, they want to see some output. It's a mix of what you did, what process you followed, what methodology you adopted, and what output you gave. So avoid listing. Listing is fine if you just want to remember what you've done, but that cannot be the end output in the resume. People want to see what output you got. Was there a result? Was there a percentage change? Something of that, a numerical output as far as possible.
So you all know that it is very easy to write that you are part of something, but it's important that what you have, say what results are coming out of your contribution. So everyone do a summer internship at some place like, say, some CSIR labs. But what impact is coming out of your work is which will make you stand. Okay, so third is personalize your resume. That is something which is based on the feedback that you will be getting from the seniors, and then how you think about the different five resumes and how you want to, say, make the person look into your resume and understand about you. So it's basically you making the person look into your resume and understand about you in your way. That is
what I would say here is that when you're trying to personalize, when you're trying to iterate your resume repeatedly and you want feedback from others, budget time. Let's say that you can make the first draft in a day, 48 hours or 3 days, that's okay. But if you want feedback from others, you need time from them, and you're not going to get that the next day. Or you're not going to get that next week as well if your seniors are working out of town. Okay. So if your resume upload deadline is August 15th, budget at least 2 to 3 weeks for these changes, for their feedback.
So one important thing, so as to understand the timeline and be aware about the process, is following the blog. So the blog is a very important thing when you are starting with the process. So that is one thing which we wanted to put before we start with the main content of the presentation.
Just on the blog, right? See, the DPC, there's a department placement coordinator, will try his or her best to update you with everything. But at times, he or she may also ignore something. So it's your responsibility to stay updated with what's going on the blog. See, MTech resumes tend to be very academic. See, let's accept it. We are generally presenting a very academic, very research-oriented profile, and that's okay, but then you have to make that your strength. So here are a few sections, okay, and if you look at the order, scholastic achievements, key projects, and seminar applications, these would come up first in your resume if you want to make a research-oriented profile, if you're targeting co-companies, okay? So you can bring in some of your positions of responsibility, okay, but make sure that you show an impact. Participating or being a volunteer, let's be realistic, it doesn't count. People want to see what leadership element you had. Did you lead a team? And if you do not have that, then the best thing is not to focus on that. Focus on your strengths. Focus on your MTech project instead.
Right, so when you are looking into your core resume, you should better focus on your publications. Put your scholastic achievements and these things in the top. No one, So when R&D profile is something is there, no one cares about your positions of responsibility that much. So you need to, and when you are making the other resumes for profiles like analytics or say semi-code kind of profile, then you need to put these things also having some impact, right?
Also, what I suggest is that within your department, let's take the example of civil engineering. Try to find out what type of companies come, okay? Because see, you can say that there is a construction firm like Shapoorji, and there's a design firm like, say, Atkins. Now, these two firms are kind of fundamentally different, so they would probably look at different resumes. Now, Atkins is more of a cross-country service-based company, so they want to see how good you are technically, what you've done in your MTech project through and through. They may not be so bothered with your project management or leadership skills. Whereas, say, a company that is putting you on site, like Shapoorji, wants to see how good you are as a project manager. So you have to be a little tactical. And for this, it's very important that you get in touch with your seniors and find out what kind of companies are coming, and then tune your resumes accordingly.
So this is one thing that comes into your resume automatically from the placement website. So once you upload your resume in the portal, you'll be getting a header. So there are 5 options of resumes, and the header will be different in those resumes. Like this is a typical 2-page resume header. The 1-page resume header will only have your BTech and MTech qualification details and not your schooling details. So these things will come into your resume automatically. And so below this thing, you have to put your resume content.
Actually, this makes life simpler if you have to make the entire resume on your own. Now you don't have to worry about your GPA, how it's going to appear, about your past ACADS. When you start preparing your resume, ignore the first few lines and then just come down straight to your project, straight to your internships. Don't worry about your GPA, about which school you went to, because that's already there.
The first section that we have put up in the major sections of the resumes, so which is scholastic achievement. This is something which everyone puts in the top. So this is something which is important for the core companies as well, because they are looking into how good you are in your curriculum. So there are many things that people put into scholastic achievements, like their GATE or JAM score. Then the scholarships make an impact because you are already a person who is standing out of the other people getting a scholarship or something. So you have already been a part of the selection process. Then medals or ranks, and then people here in IIT Bombay giving faces to AP grade also. So if you have an AP grade or something in a course which is relevant to the company, putting it in scholarship achievement is something which is beneficial. The other things are compared ranks and GRE scores, yeah.
Also look, you know, the GATE ranks, right? See, most of our batchmates have also got good ranks, okay? So you got to think a little that, is there something better that you can put? For example, if you've got a good rank and the state government of your respective state honored you, for example, then make that as the story, that, you know, I was honored by XYZ state government because I got a good rank. Okay, make that your story. It's just saying that I got this rank or I was in the top 1 percentile may not have the same impact. Especially in this environment, because you're competing with your fellow 20, 25 batchmates, 60 batchmates who also got good ranks, right?
So here you can play with things also when you're having, say, an award from your state or something, or from your, say, school which is having combination of, say, 5-10 schools. No one knows about those awards, but you can put those awards like Santish, say, some random Ram Prasad award for this day's work or something. It does bring an impact, and in this way you can put things in such a way that people will think that you are getting a big award or something. So in this way you can play while putting the things in scholastic achievements. A small award from some organization also can make an impact. So we can see there are different formats in which we can put our scholastic achievements or key achievements. So it's up to you, like you want to put publication first or achievement first. So these two things makes an impact if you're having a journal publication or something. Scholastic achievements is something which we find that 80 or 90% of the people put in the top. So you can see how people have put up their scholastic achievements in this. That your department rank also makes an impact, like you'll be having a specialization rank also. So people do put their specialization rank. No need to put that you are standing in the position of first out of 7 students. You just put that rank first in this specialization department. So in this way you can show them that you are having something better than other people. there is one big doubt that people are having about GATE scores, like how to, whether to put the GATE percentile or the All India rank. That is, so it is basically dependent on how many people are sitting for the for your department. Like for the departments like mechanical or say civil or something where many people are giving the GATE, then you can put the numbers like 8100 candidates or say lakhs of candidates. So if you are putting your rank of 200 or 300 also, then if you are writing amongst this many number of people, then it makes an impact. But if you are writing say only the rank of 150, then there are people in your batch who are having better ranks than you. So at that point you need to switch from the All India rank to percentile if you are having a better percentile. So percentile of 99 plus is something which looks different.
You have to make the M.Tech project the focus of your resume as a postgraduate student. Okay, and I have seen that a lot of people do very good research, but unfortunately they're not able to communicate it well. Okay, so this is a brief outline that you can follow. Okay, what is the aim objective of your project? People should be able to read a line and say, okay, what is this person doing? Is he designing something? Is he involved in some kind of experimental research? Is he working in chemistry lab? What is it that this person is doing? Okay, typically when you would upload your resume, you would have probably completed 20% of your M.Tech project, just done some literature review. So you can say what all you've done in the past. Okay, and be very tactical in what you want to do in the future. You have to make an impact, and probably you don't have an output at that point of time. But you can always say that you plan to do this, you plan to make a field trip somewhere. Okay, and try to show as much as possible some kind of numerical output. For example, I'm doing this research, or this research is being done because this hasn't been done in the past in anywhere in India or a foreign country or something like that. That will give you some leverage, you know, when you're interviewing. So this is one thing. Another thing is that when you type your lines for the M.Tech project, be prepared to also explain that in the interview. Okay, because if you write something very generic and then questions come up in the interview, you should be able to defend your M.Tech project thoroughly. So apart from that, then there can be secondary projects as well, probably a seminar, a bachelor's degree project if you've done, or something in your work experience between B.Tech and M.Tech as well. Okay, but make the M.Tech project the focus of your income after scholastic achievements, that's fine. Okay, but ensure that you're able to relay the story as well as possible.
So in my last year, one experience of last year, so I've seen people suffering in this portion of the resume, M.Tech project. So they are coming after the deadline also that they want to change one line in their M.Tech project, or say they have written something wrong in their M.Tech project. So this is something which is very important, because this thing you leave till the last moment, and then in the last day of the resume making, you just put up anything in the M.Tech project part. And this is something which is very important for the core companies at least. And the non-core companies also look into M.Tech project, because they're giving one year of your M.Tech into this project. So this is something which will be taking the last one. So before joining the organization, the last one year you are working into this M.Tech project only. This should be properly written, like you should be having proper impact also shown in the, that what is your future work, that is also bring a impact. So people will shortlist you based on your M.Tech project also.
Another thing is that the projects are a better way to explain what statistics, what softwares you know. For example, you forget to write that you know Ansys or you know MATLAB in your M.Tech project, but below you just write a list, softwares I have used, or softwares, and below that you just list MATLAB, R programming, SAS, whatever. That has less of an impact. Rather, you can say that in the M.Tech project, this model was built in Ansys with so and so parameters, or etc. You can glorify that. So that makes more of an impact. People can trust that yes, you really know MATLAB inside out.
And it should not be in the format of an objective or aim of the M.Tech project. So people generally write their aim of the project directly into their resume. It should be something like, yeah, that you are developing something or you are benchmarking something. So this kind of works will bring an impact, and people will read your M.Tech project properly. If you are writing words like you are developing something, you are characterizing a method or something. So these are the general formats. Like here you will find the first line of the M.Tech project to be designed or customized some software or something, some program to make the process better. Or your future work can be also put up in such a way that they'll think that this person must have done something in the last 2-3 months. So companies are basically aware that we have a deadline here, and the resumes are closed by some time. So there must be developments into your M.Tech project also. So the second important part of your, say, which includes your projects as well, is how you put your course projects, how you put your seminars, how you put your BTEC projects into your resume. This is something which is important because you must not have used your projects into your BTEC resume, but here people list 6-7 projects into their resume. Because now you are master's students, you must be specialized in something. So if you are targeting an energy-based firm, so you must be having 2-3 projects in your resume which are, say, similar to that field. So that is easy when you, say, have all the course projects and seminars written somewhere. So that's why you need to, say, mine the content right now and put everything in one document so that you can make the resume out of that.
What happens, especially for some of the departments like aerospace, metallurgy, you can't control what kind of companies are going to turn up on campus. For example, I'll give you my example. I was an environmental engineering student. Now, if I had loaded my resume with only aerosol research projects or only sustainability research projects, and the companies who turn up on campus want reactor designers, okay, and I have nothing to show about reactor designers. So it's fine, I may not have done a master's project in reactor design, but at least I can show some of the smaller projects that I did in reactor design. That gives me a chance to at least try for one of those companies. So be a little tactical, try to diversify your profile with some of the other smaller projects that you've done.
And this makes an impact when you're targeting on core profiles also. So like you must have done a small course in which you are using MATLAB to do some research based project, but you can put it in such a way that you have done this course project in which you have to use the statistical methods, or you have to use some tools which are being used in analytics fields or something. In this way you can put an emphasis by using a course project also, that you are interested doing your course also in these fields. So this will help you defend yourself while you are going for non-core profiles like analytics or software. The general point is, you in the course project or MTech project, you should put the name of the professor also. This is also something which makes an impact because the industries which are coming here are generally having consulting projects here. So the R&D people generally are aware about the names of the professors who are working here. So if your professor is a well-known professor in field of industry, he's having some good consulting projects or something, then the professor's name and other details makes an impact. And then the duration of the project is something which is very important. If you're not putting the timeline also with your resume, like when you have done this project and for how many months, generally they don't get an idea about how much impact this project is having over the other projects. So this is very important when you're putting information.
Also, you guys know that you can upload a one-page and a two-page resume. So you gotta be very cautious with how you design your one-page resume. You'll have to be short with your sentences. If you feel that there are some things that you do not want to eliminate, for example, writing a professor's name is going to take one line. So in that case, you can be a little brief with the description of your project. Else, you can switch over to your two-page resume and be as detailed as possible.
We have options of 5 resumes, in which the first resume is a one-page resume, second resume is a two-page stack resume, and the other 3 resumes are up to you. Like you can have it of one page or 2 page. But generally most of the companies will prefer a 1 page resume over a 2 page resume. So you should have a 1 page resume for tech profile as well. Not only for non-core profile, but tech profile as well.
It's very rare that an HR or anyone at a company would flip over to the page 2. So try your best to get at least one very strong 1 page resume.
So you'll find people putting their resumes in this kind of formats as well. So this shows the companies that you are able to put information in a systematic manner, and there should be a consistency in your resume. Like whenever you're looking for the name of the project title, the aim, everything should be coming in the same format in the resume. But it is easy for the person to read, because no one will. So generally, the HR gives only 10 or 15 seconds for one resume. If in that period of time, 10 seconds, they find the resume interesting, then only they'll go through the resume, otherwise they'll dump your resume. So for one profile, the final shortlist will be for 20-25 people, and there will be 300-400 people applying for that profile. It's not easy for them also to look into each resume for more amount of time. That's why you should have a proper way of presenting the resume so that the readability is increased. So here you will find that person has put up the title in one side. So if the person is not having much time, he'll at least read the write-ups and then he'll go through that project only, which is of their relevance. Also in current time, like you'll find that things like having some software exposure in your project is something which is important right now, because not much experimentation other things are happening in the industrial side. So you should have some support from the, say, if you've done some FEM simulations, you have used MATLAB or something. These things are generally having an impact, because in industries you have to use this kind of softwares.
Guys, in your undergrads have done a publication and it has been published, or it's in the process of getting an approval, then no harm in pasting the link in a resume or talking about the publication in your resume. But be sure to defend that paper through and through during your interview in December. Okay, because if it's just a review paper with an abstract, right, it may not make much of an impact. Okay, but if you've done some thorough research in BTech and you're confident about it, only then place the publication. Okay, because a lot of people who've done a 2, 3, 5, 6 month BTech project will just do a namesake publication and print it. Avoid putting that, because if the publication really should carry weight, okay, then it should be published in a good impact factor journal. Because do look into these things when you list your publication.
Most of us will be having a conference publication or some general publications which are compulsory for the BTech students sometimes in their institute. So those publications does not have much of impact, but if you are having a general publication or something, you put it in a proper format in the top of the resume. That will carry an impact, and that you have to depend thoroughly, because if a publication is in your name, you should be aware about the everything about that publication. And this is something which is important for master students, because even if you're interested in non-core profile, what you have done in your curriculum, what impact you are bringing into your field is something which they always look. Like, there will be non-core companies which are asking about your MTP also. Like, in my case, my one page non-core resume was also having publication in the top, because I wanted to show them that being a master student, I've done something impactful in my core field as well. Then we are putting the things like POR. Above that, I have put up the publications in non-core resume also.
This is an example that you can follow. As you can see, that the person has mentioned the research paper, and he has also described what that research was about. Just don't paste the link or just say that I had a research paper in XYZ conference. Okay, but people want to know the details about that research paper as well. So if you do plan to put a research paper, budget another 2-3 lines to explain that research paper.
And then you'll find people playing in this field also. Like, if your paper was selected in some renowned conference, like TMS or some, say, IIT or something, but you're not able to present there or go there, so you can write things like abstract selected in this conference. That also brings an impact. And if you're having enough space in your resume left, then you can write things like this, that your abstract was selected for this conference, because you can present a proof for that. So for everything which you are putting in your resume, you'll need some proof to defend while the verification. And journal name is something which is important when you are looking for core companies. The core research kind of profiles, they are mostly aware about the journals. So journal name and the publication year will be very important.
Yeah, those of you who have got work experience between BTech and MTech is actually a huge plus. Okay, we do understand that obviously BTech, job straight after BTech, you would have less of a leadership role, and you just new in the job, but you'll have to learn how to sell that work experience, however simple or down-to-earth it may be. So whatever you've done between BTech and MTech, it can be a huge sell, but really depends how you bring out the impact factor. Okay, how did it help the company? Even if it involves a bit of exaggeration, that's okay. But just saying, you know, I worked at Larsen & Toubro for 2-3 years, and I was assigned to a project in Surat, doesn't really help. People want to know what you did in that project.
So here one important thing is how you present your position as well. Like writing the position as an intern in NML Jamshedpur, intern in, say, Google, doesn't bring an impact. You have to write specifically that if you have done a non-core intern, like marketing intern or a research intern or something like this. Like, and here the undergrads have this tendency of bringing an impact by showing a curve. Say they have improved the process by this percentage or something. So while you have done a project in your internship or your work experience, you must have done something, some project, and you must have increased the efficiency, or you have brought up some, say, impact via your project. That is something which is important in your internships, because you have worked in an organization and you have contributed towards that project in some way or another. So that is something which is important in your internships. So as you can see that how proper formatting helps in putting information properly here in the internships or work experience section as well. So many of you will be having experiences in, say, companies like L&T or something. So these things you can properly put so that these brings an impact over the other students who are not having work experience.
As you can see here, right, that italicized line, it's a very good summary of what the person has done at Parley Global. So if the HR manager or the general manager of the company does not have time to read the resume in detail, at least he can get to know from that one single line. If he has the time, he'll read the details, or he'll ask you the details in the interview. Okay, so that's something that you guys can consider, trying to summarize it in that one short line just below the head.
So one italics line, having a brief description about what you have done, and then the other details is generally something which you can follow. So work experience is one important section for MTech students or PG students. That's why we have this general format of how you put your work experience, so that you can divide it properly and how you can bring more impact into this. So, like, the one important thing here is something like mention your project size or how many people you are working with. So you are working in a team of 6 people in this project is something which is important for the company, because you will be joining a team there, and team player is something which is the company always looking into you. So team management skills, how good you are into doing a project with a team of 6 people or 10 people, or how good you are into managing, say, a team of 6 GETs or something, people who are having more work experience can bring those things into your resumes. Like, how big budget you have handled during your, say, 2 years of work experience. These kind of things will likely show that you have worked something and you have brought up an impact. So like here, you'll find a big section of only work experience. So half of the page of the resume is sometimes work experience in people having work experiences. So companies are generally more interested towards what you have done in the recent last 2-3 years, not what you have done in your BTEC when you are having a work experience. So BTEC projects or BTEC internships will not bring an impact when you are having a work experience, and those things have already been, say, older more than 5 years or something.
Viewers typically are very important for non-core companies for sure. They're also important for some core companies. I gave you the example of somebody who's posted on-site on a construction firm, then there is an element of project management that's involved. So in general, it's always good to have an element of leadership in your resume. Okay, you can probably dial down the importance of the resume in your two-page core engineering. You can dial down the importance of the leadership position in your two-page core resume. In general, though, it's a good idea to have something to show on the leadership front. If you're involved with an NGO, you're involved in some entity activities, and that's always a plus. But avoid putting something like, you know, I was a volunteer, I was an organizer, or something like that. It really does not carry that weight. Okay, it may carry the weight if you're applying off campus on your own when you're not a college student, but it really does not carry weight when you're applying in competition with the rest. So be very, very objective with your PORs.
Because here you will be competing with the undergrads, and they are putting the peers in a very proper way. Like a simple line like organizer at more indigo doesn't have a value here. So then you are putting organizer at your cult fest in some college, is something which will not have any value in the resume. So better to put in a format that will bring something like, this is a cult fest in which the running crowd was something like this. So how many people are participating in that event which you have, say, organized, which you have mentored or something like this. So if you are having something like this, some peers like this, so you will be having ISCB peers here. So you have to quantify those work as well. Like if you are, say, mentoring 5-6 students, right, that you are mentoring 6 students for their curricular as well as extracurricular needs. So a statement like this brings an impact that you are basically working towards how the students will gel up in the first year of a master's here. So ISCP Simple Viewer will also have a value when you're writing in this format.
It's good to show some leadership element, but viewers are not the only way. You can show that through some of your research projects as well. You know, if you were involved in an internship where you had to lead a team of workers somewhere, then that's also leadership. If you do not have any credible PORs for some reason, you do not participate in your undergraduate, that's fine, that's okay. But in that case, I would suggest that it's better to just skip the section altogether and use it for something else, like extracurriculars or ECADS or something like that. Okay, but there should not be a POR deemed sick. If you have a POR, then as he said, try to defend it, try to bring in the leadership element.
Yeah, and then one important PR that people generally use in their core resume as well as non-core resume is a teaching assistantship. This is also a PR when you are mentoring, say, so if you are writing statement like you have designed a curriculum with the professor for 100 plus students for this course, is something which might bring an impact. But if you are writing only teaching assistantship in CS101 course or HS101 course, this doesn't count at all. So when you are writing the number of the students and then you use the words like designed a curriculum, right? You must have made a presentation or simple, just you have checked the, you have made a plan with the professor, but you have to write it in a way that you are having an impact with the professor during this course or during this teaching assistantship. So if you're looking into a, say, center facility or something, like laboratories or something, you can write that you have tested more than 200 samples in last one semester or something like this. So this is something which will show that you are consistent and you can do something, things which are, say, coming daily in your life. So there will be many repetitive tasks which are happening in the when you are working in your organizations. Similar kind of things will be happening on a daily basis. So with these things, you can bring those kind of profiles into your resumes that you have tested more than 200 samples, something which is interesting for the companies. Like how can you do such so many testing and other things in one semester only? So in this, we have to write the teaching assistantship because MTs will generally write about TA and RA work. So it should be, say, having an impact and it should be something unique from the other students because everyone will be having this section in the resume, definitely. So you can see in this inserted, there are two POs, like one is marketing, manager in marketing, and second is teaching assistantship. So both things will bring two kind of, matlab, values into your resume, to this section. Like you can see here that he is writing guided 13 students. So this kind of thing generally.
As a bottom line, try to bring in numbers as much as you can. Yeah, just reread it so it doesn't sound silly. As much as possible, bring in numbers. How many students you mentored as a teaching assistant, how many experiments you did to come to an output, something of that sort. But just try to think in some kind of numerical output.
At the end, if you're not having anything, you can write about examined more than 100 papers also. Like student final term paper. Examined more than 100 term papers. This is something is also fine because if you're not having much impact into your things, you can write it this way. And the point should not exceed more than 2 lines. It should generally be 1 line statements only. Because then it should be like kind of a paragraph or something, then people are not interested in reading. When you are using bullets into your resume, it should be 1 or 2 lines, maximum 2 lines. And then the other point that I was mentioning about ISCP. So you see here how people are writing about ISCP, that work in a team of 17 people and for 90 plus PG freshmen. So when you are writing in as a team, you can mention big numbers. When you are writing as a team of the whole institute, you can write that working in a team of 50 people so as to mentor 1000 plus students. So in this way you can bring numbers also and you can bring impact also.
You can make this a guideline that do not exceed 2 lines. Okay? You can play with the font a little, okay, 10, 11. I'm not sure about the guidelines, but the restrictions, sorry, from the placement office. But as a policy, do not exceed 2 lines. A 3-line description just shows that you're not able to summarize accurately what you've done in 2 lines. Okay? As far as possible, stick with 1 line, that's the best. But if not, you can go to the 2nd line. So you've seen a lot of the content that we've shown in this resume. Hardly anything is crossed over to the 3rd line.
And then having things like table of action or something. So you can bring tables and other things in your resumes. You have to show your skills which are more into, say, documentation and other things. So how you can write everything in one page or something. So one page resume is very important because you need to understand the importance of what you have done. So you must be having 10 projects. But you need to understand the importance of top 3 projects and put that only in the resume. That is something which is important. Then your PRs in sports things also does count in some of the organizations, which like companies like Slumberger or something does put much emphasis into your extracurriculars or PRs in sports fields. So these things shows that you are able to manage your time, decide your curriculum into your self-development as well. So extracurrics is something which is the last part of your resume, generally we put. But these are the things which makes your resume interesting. So HRs are generally people who are looking into extracurriculars sometimes just to understand about you, more about you. That you must have done research, so there will be 5 students in your department who have done wonderful research. But out of 5, who is the person who will gel up with the team, who will enjoy the work in the team, or will stay in the team? So these things can be seen into your extracurriculars when you're having something like you have participated in dance competition in your college fest. That is also fine.
Typically, the ending of any HR interview would circle on your extracurricular activities. What do you like reading? Do you go trekking or something of that sort? In fact, I remember a guy was actually asked to sing during his interview because he said that he's very passionate about singing. So that's where extracurriculars can make a difference. However, we did discuss about 6 sections, if I remember correctly. Scholastic, positions of responsibility, projects, work experience, extracurricular. It's very unlikely that you can fit 6 in a 1-page resume. So you really have to be tactical and decide what your strengths are and pick out those top 3, top 4. Obviously, scholastic and MPEC research project would be common for most of the master's students. Probably MSc students, those who have not done a research project, MSc math students can play around a bit with their extracurricular activities a bit more.
And there should be an order of mention, like when you are putting 2 sports points, they should be together and you can write sports in front of them. Then you can, so generally for non-core profiles, putting it in a format where you are showing 2-3 different kind of exposures in extracurriculars also is something which is good. So like you can put 2 points for sports, 1 for cult activities and then 1 for technical or something kind of exposure. So NGO experiences and these things are also sometimes good because companies are generally connected with NGOs or CSR activities. So these kind of things in the last part of your resume will bring a, say, emotional connect to you, like, and then people do write about trekking or something else as well, like trekking or singing, or if you're having some good hobbies or something which also people mentioned here. So then you must be aware about everything about that hobby, and then your interview might go into that direction also, like if you write a blog or something, and that the same person who is sitting in front of you is enthusiastic about blogs and other things, your interview might go into this also, and you will be selected based on only your blog writing skills or something like this. Sometimes interview do go in these directions. So here is an advantage of putting things in 2-page resume, that you can put many things in your 2-page resume. This is one screenshot from the 2-page resume.
When you're talking about your extracurriculars, that matter, even if you're talking about where you work, and if you work in some place which is in a remote area, like this guy, he has been to the Himalayas, then do mention that place. Don't leave that out. People want to know if you've been to a place where there's some hardships to face. Okay, because think about it from the perspective of a company. If they have to post you in some remote location, they want to know that this guy is ready to work in the middle of Haryana or somewhere like that. So mention the places where you did your project, mention the places where you went trekking or where you did some extracurricular activities, where you went to an NGO or something like that.
You must be participating in activities here also in IIT Bombay. Like there are cult schools going on, summer schools and all these things. So activities like you are playing an instrument, you do play an instrument, you are a beginner in some language, like beginner in Spanish or something. These things you have to put up in extracurriculars. The last section, so that if you're sitting for a company which sends you out to the other countries, or there are many companies which are coming from Japan. So there are 10 plus companies who are directly taking people from Japan, and they prefer master students over undergrads because for the research profiles. So most of the research profiles, they're preferring you guys over them, but you should be having some content there. The foreign language or something will bring a additional value to your resume. There are many ways you can put your extracurriculars, and there are many sections. Like people do sometimes put their leadership skills also into extracurriculars when you're not making a separate PR section. So when you're not having many PRs or something, you can merge these two sections also. So the other sections can be based on your interest. Like there is a trend in the institute that a few departments generally follow this section, that area of interest in the top of the resume. So this is something which you should be writing very carefully, and this should be different in all three or four resumes. Like you can put three, four resumes having different kind of area of interest that should do the company.
In some places in the resumes, there's this one line on top where people write their objective. It's my motivation is to get into a good company and something like that. Please avoid that. Everyone here wants a good job, okay? Avoid that first one line, write an objective. My motivation is to get into a great place or something like that. Everybody's motivation is to get into a great place. So that will just eat up your words, and that is something that in general is not seen among any undergraduate student resumes. You won't find that.
Here also you'll find hardly one or two students writing objective who are not attending these sessions or who are not aware about the other people's resumes. They'll only write objectives. So no one cares about your objective, that you want to work in a wonderful organization, doing something. So these things don't add any value to your resume. Rather you write what you have done and what impact you can bring. Then technical skills section is something which is important for the master students. Like when you are applying for the core profiles, you should write about different, you can separate it into different sections, then languages, then instrument exposures. And these things, so if you look into research profiles where like Tata Steel, or you see into applied materials, Carrot and Core, where they are working into, or say some electrical board companies which are working into, say, managing a device or making devices, silicon production something. There you have to have a exposure into one of the instruments, and you'll be working into some separate project. So these instrument skills will show that you can master the instruments easily over the other students.
Formatting is going to take a lot of your time. You know, I can guarantee that you'll have to keep at least a week for formatting. Okay, and you'll have to be very thorough. Choose your font, whether it's Calibri or Cambria or something. Keep it consistent. Yeah, because you might ignore it because you're too caught up. You forgot to format the second section. Everything else is the Calibri. Just the second section is Arial. It just slipped out of your head. Or you forgot to reduce the font size. I'm sure that the person who sees it, the HR or anybody else, would notice the change. I mean, these cosmetic changes matter a lot.
A simple spelling mistake or simple formatting mistake will directly turn them down into looking at your resumes. They'll throw your resume because they are having 300 resumes. They'll easily find 20 to get good students. So if you are having a simple mistake in the last line of resume that the font size is different, that directly. And the one important thing, so when you're formatting the resumes, one important thing is white spaces, which we do put in, say, impression about you. So you should be either writing your resume in such a way that you are writing one statement or two statements. It should not be one or two words coming in the second line. It brings a white space in your resume, and then it shows that you are not able to write the things properly. Like you are not able to format the things in such a way that you can put information. So too much of white space shows that you are not having enough content for your resume. Like you must not have done much of the things. So people sometimes do write simple things just so as to fill that line, so that the white space is not present in the resume.
Think of something else, even if it was a minor project, you can just add that. Even a minor project that you did somewhere between your first and second year in BTech, that can take up 2 to 3 lines and you're fine again.
Just to end the line, you can add things like while working in a team of 5 people. So you are just ending the line, you are done with the main sentence, working in a team of 2 people, or say working using MATLAB as a some analysis software, so using this software as an analysis tool or something like this. This will help you in removing those white spaces in your resume. So this is one screenshot of how your resume looks into your BTech time and how it looks into your master's resume. So here you'll find too much of white space and lesser of content. So this is one advantage that you'll be having getting a header from here only. So you are getting a header, then you'll see that you're getting the whole, say 80% of your, 70% of your resume blanks where you can put all your information. So this is something, and here in IIT Bombay, you're not supposed to put your any contact information or any information in a way that people, the company officials can contact you. These things are not allowed. So in this way, it is very easy to focus on your main content of the resume and not on your other things. Like sometimes people are confused about putting their photo also in the resumes. These things are not required here because if you're not going for a modeling job or you're not sitting for a company looking for actors or something, then your photograph or something is not required. The main content is required, then they will judge you on interview.
Do not ignore the dates on the right. Okay, month dates, if you just go back to that. Yeah, here if you can compare the first with the second, you'll find that the first does not have any chronological order, whereas the second has. People want to know how many months you spent, how many years of work experience you had, whether it was 1.5, 2 years, etc. Okay, so put in the dates when you were there. Okay, follow the chronological order as much as you can.
And then you can see the section titles also, how these things are written in a proper way. Like writing a POR, writing it as a leadership and an organizational skills. Is something which you can prefer over the other things. Like POI is something which is common. So you can write it in such a way that it brings us a different flavor into your resume. Section title is sometimes very interesting.
You really need to boost your vocabulary, but we're hopeful that this session will help. So try and think as much as you can in reported speech, you know, plan this with this, led a team, collaborated. You know, think in the reported speech as much as possible. Try not to repeat the same words. So if you said, I analyzed the flow of whatever chemical in this project, do not use analyzed again. It'll show that you shorten vocabulary. Use some other word, assessed or gauged, or something like that. So I think in this presentation, there are a list of words that can help you. Apart from that, you can obviously use yours as well.
In some of the cases, your resume is being, reviewed or assessed in these terms also. So they'll be putting numbers in front of these skills. Or sometimes the companies directly use the software to pick up the main words into your resumes. So they'll not be looking into your resumes directly, but they'll be putting your resumes in a software which will directly get the important words, like action verbs or something like, which will show these skills. So they'll be having a proper set of words which will be coming into this section. If these words are there into your resume, you'll be getting shortlisted for the first year at least. So this is something which is common in the companies which are having more than 500 applications or something.
Do be careful with the meaning of the words. If you write something like ideated a novel way to filter out this chemical, it just doesn't make sense. If you've done an entrepreneurial, if you actually come up with an entrepreneurial idea and use the term ideated, then it makes sense. Okay, else try to use words that are easy to understand. Also just avoid repeating the same word, as he mentioned.
And choose these words very carefully when you are using an action verb or something at the beginning of the statement. That will basically make that person read about the statement. That is something which will show you how much you have worked. So if you have done a seminar and you are writing that you have proposed a solution in this field, this is something which looks a little false also, and you will not be able to defense when you have just done a literature survey and you are writing that you have proposed this solution out of the literature survey. So words should be very careful, like summarized or some words can be used in writing about literature survey or some small course project where you have not proposed a solution or you have not published anything. So these are very words which brings an impact but should be very carefully used. And then these skills, software skills or technical expertise. So they will be looking into your resumes for the words like C, C++, MATLAB, Python, R. These words they will generally encircle in your project or something. And they will directly ask about how you use MATLAB in this project. They'll not be concerned about what you did in your project. They'll be concerned about what software or other things you have used. So like for my interview in thesis R&D, a very core profile, they have asked me about a data mining course which I have done. That is something which is important for the analytics field. But they have asked about that project and what other software that I have used in that project, that course only. So it's not that only core companies will be looking into your projects and other things, they'll be looking into your diverse experience also.
This is as exhaustive as possible. I think you guys, this can be really helpful.
We'll be sending this slides to you, so you need to write these words or something. And you can easily find these words. But these words So there are many words which are present, so no need to repeat the words. You will easily find words for that statement. But starting with the action verb is something which makes a person read the whole statement. You are writing that I worked on this project for these months. Is something which is generic, but if you are writing that you have collaborated with this team to bring this impact in the work, is something which people will put more interest into.
You can get a better feel of these words if you actually see that in somebody's resume. Do make a point to get in touch with your seniors.